Yeah, excellent.
That's working? Okay, cool. And apparently you can hear me. That's great. So, yeah, okay. Thank you for inviting me there. I think we make a big change now from all these interesting talks about protein structures to now talking about RNA structure. And I hope this is nevertheless interesting for you. So I want to present to you some ideas about computational prediction of RNA-RNA interaction complexes, and specifically in the context of some interesting biology in SARS-CoV-2. So the whole motivation actually for giving this presentation today is that this spring we have been contacted by a biologist from Wuhan, Yu Zhou, and obviously he had to work on CoV-2. So he was interested in characterizing, mapping the subgenome landscape in these coronaviruses. And so it's well known that in coronaviruses, a diversity of different subgenomes is produced as transcripts from the virus genome. So it's quite accepted fact that there's this template switching mechanism that allows to produce subgenomes, so smaller fragments of these of the genome by using template switching from the plus strand and producing these negative subgenomes. But the same symmetrically could also be done in the opposite direction. So it's less known that this also exists, so that we can have positive subgenomes from the negative strand. So the hypothesized mechanism of these transcripts that can actually skip certain regions in the genome to produce subgenomes is that there is some template switch and there's some junction site where this template switch happens. And also there's some RNA-RNA interaction involved in the whole process. So one will first transcribe from some downstream site, and then this fragment that is transcribed has some stable RNA-RNA interaction, some stable pairing with some upstream junction site, and in this way it can skip over all the region in between these two sites. So in this work, you had the idea to identify those junction sites based on NGS reads and also on long nanopore reads. And of course, one could identify these reads just by these junction sites just by reads that cover exactly this junction site. So what made it interesting for us as group here, also with Jan Ponti, so to join in this project was that this RNA-RNA interaction plays such an important role, apparently, in the template switching mechanism. So I have to tell you something, or I can, readily take this as a motivation to tell you something more about the prediction of RNA-RNA interaction and also RNA structure prediction in general. Maybe slightly more than we actually need for this project, but I think it's a quite good opportunity to, and it's a fascinating topic. So it's kind of very different to predicting protein structures in several ways. So for RNA, we have this idea that we can already learn a lot about the function of these RNAs by just predicting the secondary structure. That means just predicting the context, the base pairs between the bases G and C, A and U, and G and U. So we just predict secondary structure here with the idea that there's something like hierarchical folding, that first the secondary structure is formed anyway and then is rearranged, and only on top of this, the tertiary contacts are formed. So we can already learn a lot from the secondary structure. So that's the first ingredient. But the second ingredient that makes it special is that we have quite accurate energy models on the secondary structure. So there is this nearest neighbor model with the idea that we can basically compose the total free energy of some RNA structure out of single energies of the single components in the structure, so that are actually the loops in the structure. And the energies of these loops can now be determined experimentally by doing a series of melting experiments. And that's where we have, in the end, a very accurate model that can also be treated computationally, because all these loop energies just depend on different loop size, different loop type, and the base composition, so that we can tabulate all these single contributions. Then, based on these two ideas, actually focusing on 2D structure and having this accurate energy model, so we can now understand structure prediction just as the problem to find the minimum free energy 2D structure in these models. So the interesting fact, and which makes it even more different to protein structure prediction, is that we have efficient algorithms to predict those structures. So this works by dynamic programming. So we can basically start from small subsequences between I and J, and from this go on to larger and larger subsequences until we predict the best structure for the whole RNA. And this is based on some recursive decomposition of those subsequences, where the idea is that we can just get the optimal solution for subsequence ij from just making a complete case distinction how to decompose the subsequence into smaller subproblems. And then, yeah, using this idea of dynamic programming, we tabulate everything. We really get some efficient algorithm in n to the 3 time, and we just fill a quadratic matrix and need n square space. So the whole thing, of course, is not perfect in some ways. So there are some assumptions why this can be so efficient to predict these structures. So we assume that there are no crossings in the structure. So all the base pairs can basically be arranged in some tree-like or non-crossing fashion. But this is some very useful approximation for RNA structures. So now this is general structure prediction, but I promise to talk about interaction prediction specifically. So when we now go on, so basically we can build on the same ideas that we have for structure prediction. So we still predict base pairs, so sets of base pairs in the optimal structure, but this time we have the joint MFE structure that we are interested in of the two RNAs. So we have basically the complex of the two RNAs with all the intramolecular base pairs as before, basically. And then we have the interaction base pairs, the intermolecular base pairs that we want to predict as well. So, and then we can predict some interesting or we can represent in this such a model, we can predict some interesting constellations like kissing hairpins or even more complex constructs. But if we are completely complete general there, then Alkan et al. Could show then this whole interaction prediction is still NP complete. And this is even the case if we restrict ourselves to a rather simple intramolecular structure, but we still want to predict all these intermolecular base pairs that cause the interaction between our two RNAs. And they did not stop there to show that it's NP complete, but they showed that if we make some restriction, if we disallow so-called zigzag motifs, as we see here, so the zigzag of the interaction is quite visible here. So then we can have an efficient algorithm again. So again, dynamic programming, where we want to decompose now the two subsequences at the same time. And I can quickly try to explain why we cannot do this if we have zigzag. So when we do this and we just nibble off all the unpaired bases here, and then we in the next step, we want to nibble off some of the base pairs, then we're here in the zigzag conformation. So we have the problem that we don't have any base pair that exposes both ends at the ends of these subsequences. So we don't have any way to look at the two ends at the same time and assign the correct energies. So that's why we end up in such a frozen conformation configuration if we have zigzags. So, but of course, n to the sixth time is still very complex for interaction prediction. So that's quite limiting, even if it's efficient. So there are some ideas how to predict interactions in a more restricted, more specialized setting in much faster time. So, and one of the most prominent ideas here is to use actually co-folding. So in co-folding, the idea is that we just look at the concatenation of the two RNAs. So then we end up in a situation that's actually very similar to having only one sequence. Now we just have the concatenation of the two sequences. And we could have the idea again to apply now dynamic programming in the same way to the concatenation as we did apply it to the single sequence. And yeah, this is now not possible using the same algorithm as long as we have crossings. Yeah, so just to remind you, crossing, basically this red stem here is crossing the other stems. So that would correspond here to some kissing hairpin-like configuration. But once we drop these crossings, so we still can predict very interesting interactions. So in this way, in this case, so if we disallow crossings, we can predict interactions where the two RNAs are in contact just outside of any internal structure. And then we can apply our cubic time structure prediction algorithm again. Yeah, in some situations we have even simpler settings, or we have even more knowledge about our biology, and we can, for example, know that we are not interested in any intramolecular structure. In such cases, we have even faster algorithms that work basically like if we forbid completely any branching in co-folding, or are almost like sequence alignment in n square time. So that's basically also everything that we really needed for the application to CoF2. So just to go back now to the biology. So we said we are interested in these template switches. And the template switch could now happen either positive to positive strand just while producing the negative transcript, or in the opposite direction, jumping on the negative strand. And just to focus first on the positive strand template switch. So what we get here is that the template is produced, starting from the right side. And what we get is first the DR region here is transcribed, and we get some anti-DR sequence in the transcript. Now the mechanism is hypothesized to work as follows. So the anti-DR is then pairing forming very stable RNA-RNA interaction with some upstream region here. That's the part of the upstream junction site, UR. And then the transcription can continue not at the DR, the downstream junction site, but it can now continue on the upstream junction site, and in this way skip this inner region. Now, what we would expect is that we see this stable interaction between UR and anti-DR, but of course, the interaction between UL and anti-UL is not particularly stable. And that's exactly what we can observe for junction sites, at least where we have a lot of reads that confirm these junction sites. So we can observe that the interaction here between UR and anti-DR is much more stable than the interaction between UL and anti-DL, as we hypothesized. And and interestingly now, if we have the opposite template switch, so the negative to negative template switch, we should also observe exactly the opposite ratio, namely that we have a much more stable energy here stabilizing the interaction between UL and anti-DL compared to the interaction between UR and anti-DR. And what's so interesting now for us here is that we can use that to really distinguish these two types of template switch. So this provides us some way to classify all the observed and confirmed template switches that we kind of infer from the sequencing results from all these reads. And yeah, so what we see as a result is that we can really create a map of all the possible junctions, all the possible template switches that we observe in CoronaCoV2. And we can even classify now using this idea of comparing the stability of the two sites of the junction site into the negative to negative switches and the positive to positive switches. So this thermodynamic information that we get due to the prediction of the best interaction is even more useful in some respects. So we can use that to verify certain hypotheses that we could have about this mechanism of the template switching. So basically there were two main hypotheses due to the observations in this paper. First, the idea was that, okay, we observe this template switch not only on the positive strand when the negative subgenome is transcribed, but it's also observed in the opposite direction. And that's exactly what we could see from this analysis here, where we compare the energies, the stabilities of the two parts of the junction site. So we see that there's really the significant difference that would not be expected if there would not be we would not have a positive to positive as well as negative to negative switches. So the other important hypothesis about the mechanism of template switching, of course, was that this RNA-RNA interaction really plays such an important role, because that kind of controls how we get from one junction site to the other junction site, because there we have the stable RNA-RNA interaction. And we can now use this bioinformatics analysis to confirm this or provide additional evidence to this hypothesis, because what we see is that if we have very well confirmed junction sites, then we also observe very good stabilities. And the stability is nicely correlated, so to the number of reads that confirm our junction sites. So with this, I can already thank you for your attention. So I was kind of faster than I expected. I have some take-home messages for you. So first, what we have seen is that RNA structure prediction and also the interaction prediction is something very different to protein structure prediction. So it works based on first this assumption that we can work on secondary structure, all these base pairings in RNAs, where we have very accurate energy models that describe how the energy depends on all these interactions. And we have really efficient algorithms to predict these structures. So, but of course, for having efficiency, what we have also seen on the example of RNA-RNA interactions, so we make very controlled restrictions, so we cannot, as well as for proteins, so we cannot really solve the full problem efficiently. But if we make some controlled restrictions, then we have these efficient algorithms to predict our structures and interactions. So on the biology side, so the take-home messages would be, so we have these diverse subgenomes in coronavirus, and in this work, so we could even basically map all the observed subgenomes in SARS-CoV-2. And all these subgenomes are produced based on some mechanism template switching. And in this work, we learned somewhat more about how this template switching works. So we could use the bioinformatics analysis, this RNA-RNA interaction prediction, to support two main hypotheses about the template switching mechanism. Namely, first, this idea that RNA-RNA interaction really plays an important role in template switching. That's something we see by this very obvious correlation between the read count number and the stability. And we can also see that this provides evidence that that template switching really happens on both strands. Yeah, just by observing this difference in stability between one part of the junction site and the other. Yeah, then thank you again. And yeah, and you're welcome to ask questions.
Thank you, Sebastian. So, questions.
I think there's a question by Thomas Schiex.
Excusez-moi, mais je suis en plein repas, du coup. La question, c'était pourquoi à tout prix s'accrocher à cette absence de pseudo-nœud?
Sorry, can you ask in English, please?
To not having pseudonauts and instead keep them and use ILP or MaxSAT or WCSP NP complete solvers, which have made huge progress.
Yeah, so that's certainly really interesting. So of course, as soon as we want to allow certain pseudonauts, what we can do using just dynamic programming also has some limitations, because then we can write down more complex dynamic programming recursions to maybe cover larger classes of pseudonauts, but of course, there always have to be some restrictions on the classes of pseudonauts if we use dynamic programming.
Use
some other methods like you described, to cover maybe general pseudonauts.
Many of these NP complete solvers are now, dynamic programming aware in some sense. So when they identify a substructure which are manageable using dynamic programming, they try to emulate it.
That sounds super cool. So, if you would basically get some efficiency automatic on the parts that can be solved by dynamic programming, or where we can maybe infer some bounds from dynamic programming. So that's kind of also what I observed in my own research, that this could really help handle such pseudonaut problems much faster than some tailored dynamic programming algorithms could do.
If you're interested, maybe we can discuss this later. Just contact me by emails. I'm interested. Bye.
This is also very interesting for me. Thanks for the comment.